Hi, and welcome back to Focal Point AFR Talk. Do you remember Ted Cruz saying, look, the number to call, by the way, 888-589-8840, 888-589-8840. Ted Cruz saying, look, President Obama had nothing to say. 5 million people have lost their insurance under Obama. Five million people have had insurance canceled under Obama, and that's just on the individual policies. If President Obama had not waived the employer mandate for a year, that number would be in the hundreds of millions, literally. There would be 100 million people who would have had their insurance canceled right now as you and I are sitting here talking. It's catastrophic what it's doing to the American people. It's sending, you know, we had this story. In fact, Rob, let's start with this one because I had a story. I won't take time to find it, but a guy checked into an emergency room with a rash. And 8 hours later, he was dead. He hadn't been attended to. Nobody had seen him. Nobody had examined him. He sat in the emergency room for 8 hours, and then he died. Now, that's where we're headed with Obamacare. It's going to be just like health care in the U.K., where there's a huge story over there in the U.K. We've talked about occasion where people just die on gurneys in the hallways of the hospitals. Rob, let's grab clip number 19 if we can. This is Charles Krauthammer talking about this. You know, and most of the people that have gotten insurance, most of them have gone on Medicaid. And the whole point of Medicaid, what we were promised, is that, hey, if we go to Medicaid, it's going to cut down on emergency room visits. This will be good. It'll take the pressure off of hospitals. People get a cold now. Where do they go? They go to the emergency room. And because of this law that was passed in 1986, terrible law if you ask me, they can't turn anybody away. They have to treat them whether the people can pay for it or not. And so people are using the emergency room, which is very expensive medical care, using it as a doc in the box, as a corner medical clinic. And so Medicaid and this Obamacare plan is supposed to fix all of that. Here's a guy spends 8 hours sitting in the emergency room and dies. They found him dead, cold, blue at 4 o'clock in the morning. Nobody even noticed. Who knows how long he'd been sitting there dead in the emergency room at this hospital. And here's what Charles Krauthammer had to say about this whole Medicare, Medicaid ER thing.
Well, I'm not sure how large the impact will be, although because they've radically increased the ceiling under which you're allowed to get Medicare. It used to be the very poor, so you didn't really have estates that you could raid for money afterwards. Now a whole bunch of people who are middle class own their own homes are now being shoved into Medicaid, so you will have the problem. It's hard to estimate how many it'll be. But to me it just shows how thoughtless and arrogant was the planning of all this. People said, you know, the experts sit here in Washington and say, well, let's expand Medicaid up to a certain level, arbitrary level, without thinking it through. One of the reasons that Medicaid was expanded was because the assumption was, it was a reasonable assumption, that it will decrease the amount of visits to the ER by the poor. So it would save a lot of money. That was the premise. Well, there's been a study in Oregon, a randomized study of people assigned into Medicare and outside, that shows that it actually increases the use of the ER by 40%.
So this is in Oregon. And also what they did in Oregon, they did an extensive study on people that had health care through Medicaid compared with people who had no health insurance at all. And the people under Medicaid that had health insurance had this precious insurance that President Obama cannot stop talking about, government-paid-for insurance, single-payer, Medicaid's a single-payer program. There was no difference in the health outcomes, none, zip, zero. So all that money, as far as health outcomes for people in Oregon, it was wasted money. They did just as well without Medicaid as they did with it. So all of that money that was spent on Medicaid had no discernible benefit for the health of people in Oregon, and emergency room visits went up with people who had Medicaid. And maybe part of the deal is they think they've got insurance, they can use this, they go anywhere they want, walk into emergency rooms thinking, well, hey, my Medicaid will take care of it. I don't have to wait and go to the doctor, whatever. Here's the story from Jammy Wearing Fools. It's a blog site, and it's an excerpt from a news story. He walked into St. Barnabas Hospital asking to be treated for a rash, but more than 8 hours later, John Verrier was found dead in his chair in the crowded ER waiting room, hospital officials concede. The 30-year-old amateur artist may have been dead for hours, according to a mortified employee who was there in the Bronx emergency room Monday morning when the corpse was finally discovered. He was found stiff, blue, and cold, the employee said, speaking to ABC News on condition of anonymity. He died because there's not enough staff to take care of the number of patients we see each day. We need more staff at St. Barnabas. Now, we know that Obamacare is knocking people off their health care. They're losing their insurance. Here's Tom Coburn, and let's grab clip number 8, Rob, if we can. Tom Coburn, Senator Tom Coburn, he's fighting prostate cancer. It's serious enough that he's actually going to retire from the Senate at the end of this session. There's going to be a race in Oklahoma to replace him. Coburn is one of the good guys, been just an absolute bulldog on government waste and all that. But he discovered and talked about this yesterday that his Obamacare insurance plan, which he's required to have under law, doesn't cover his cancer specialist. So he's been dealing with prostate cancer now for several years. He's had a recurrence of that prostate cancer, and he's lost coverage for his oncologist. Had a great oncologist, and Obamacare plan will not cover his oncologist, so he doesn't have access to specialists under his insurance plan, so he's going to have to pay for it out of pocket. Now, apparently he's in a position where he can do that. A lot of people aren't going to be in that position. A lot of ordinary people like you and me, they don't have the deep pockets that Tom Coburn has, so they lose their specialist. They're not going to be able to go see him anymore. And here is what Coburn says. He talks about this yesterday, clip number 8 with MSNBC. Here's how it went.
I'm doing well from a health standpoint. Got great docs, and fortunately, even though my new coverage won't cover my specialist, I'm going to have great care, and I have a great prognosis.
So he says, look, I'm doing fine because I'm able to pay out of pocket for my own specialist, which Obamacare won't pay for. I don't get any help from Obamacare. I had it before with my old insurance. President Obama said, you like your insurance, you can keep it. Well, I like my insurance. Enabled me to see some fine oncologists and cancer specialists. I didn't get to keep my insurance. I didn't get to keep my doctor. So the lie of the year now zinging even lawmakers. Now, you would think that this would arouse some compassion on the part of the left. Remember, I've said the myth that liberals are more compassionate than conservatives is a bald-faced myth. It is totally untrue. It's just complete garbage. It's total swill. There is simply absolutely no truth to that whatsoever. In fact, I find in my personal experience, conservatives are far more compassionate, far more tender-hearted, far more generous, far more sympathetic, far more willing to give of time, talent, and treasure to help the downtrodden than liberals. Now, I'm not saying it's true of every liberal. I'm not saying it's true of every conservative. I'm not saying that. But I'm talking in general, my personal experience, what I've observed, I think conservatives are far more compassionate as people than liberals are. Well, here's Paul Krugman, and I give you Paul Krugman as Exhibit A. Now, here's Tom Coburn. This guy's dealing with prostate cancer. Prostate cancer took my dad. My dad died from prostate cancer. This is not a harmless thing. It's not an incidental thing. And Tom Coburn is dealing with what could be a cancerous disease that could take his life. And he says Obamacare took my insurance away, took my specialist away. Here's Paul Krugman, hardcore leftist. Now, this is Mr. Compassion. These are the tolerance gurus here, the people that say we're the compassionate ones. You're hard-hearted, you're stingy, you're cold-hearted. We're the paragons of compassion and tolerance. We're the ones that have a heart for people. Here's Newt Gingrich and Paul Krugman talking about Tom Coburn's situation.
I just point out, speeches are terrific. And Clinton came in and sold health care, and it lasted 4 days. And then it disintegrated in 1993-94. The problem this president has is that this morning, Senator Tom Coburn announced he had lost his cancer doctor under the Obamacare bill.
Yeah.
Now, that kind of stuff,
it's a totally misleading story, by the way.
Of course it is, Paul.
Nobody has ever found that their private insurer has told them that the doctor they were using is no longer in network.
I know it's hard for you to hear this. It's
a garbage story. It really is.
That's Paul Krugman. This is a garbage story. Here's a guy that lost his insurance, lost access to his specialist unless he paid for it out of his own pocket. And Paul Krugman, that's garbage. I mean, that is some liberal compassion for you. 888-589-8840, number to call. Let's go to Angela, Sanford, North Carolina. Now, Angela, welcome to Focal Point with Brian Fisher. What's on your mind?
Hey, Brian. How are you?
I'm doing fine. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well. So I have a question for you. When I saw President Barack Obama accept his oath, I noticed that he was putting his hand on two books. It appeared that the Bible was underneath another document that was on top. And so knowing his history, I was wondering to myself, well, what is that document that was on top? Was it the Quran or was it something else?
Now, that's the first I've heard of that. That you're saying that when Obama was sworn in for the second time, he took the oath on two books?
Yeah, I noticed, and I could be wrong, but I noticed there was one book, and it looked like the Bible underneath a smaller book, and he had his hand on top of that smaller book. So technically, if he did have his hand on something different, in his mind, he may not have been taking the oath under the Bible.
Now, this jogged my memory, and I looked it up very quickly. I think President Obama actually used two Bibles when he was sworn in. So they were both Bibles. One of them was a Bible owned by Martin Luther King Jr., and the other was a Bible that was used by Abraham Lincoln. So that's the answer to the question. It wasn't a Quran. He was actually sworn in on two Bibles. You know, which really, if you think about it, if he took an oath on two Bibles, he violates that oath. That makes it even more serious. I mean, in God's economy, if you're amping this up by using two Bibles instead of one, then you're telling God, I'm really taking this oath seriously. So when you swear to uphold the laws of the land and defend the Constitution, and then you don't do it, that's a pretty serious thing. All right, Angela, listen, I appreciate the call. That's a good question. I had forgotten all about that. When we come back, I was going to do it last segment. I'm going to do it next segment, kind of walk through. I'll take some phone calls at the beginning of the segment, but then I want to walk through what I think is the solution to what we're dealing with here. You know, we are dealing with a lawless president who is not bound by the law. He's not bound by the Constitution. He doesn't fear anybody. He has no fear of any kind of repercussions. He has no fear of any kind of reprisals. He knows that the Republicans don't have the testosterone to impeach him. And he knows that the Democrats don't have the guts or the courage or the conviction or whatever to convict him. So he knows he can get away with anything he wants to. Who is going to stop him? Well, that's the question I've got, and I believe I've got an answer to that question. I know who can stop him, and we'll talk about that when we come back. Focal Point, AFR Talk.